Hi, my name is Bernadette John. I'm actually a nurse and midwife by background, and I've worked in the medical school for the last 6 years teaching history taking and communication skills. And I have a lot of interest in social media. And about 3 years ago, I became aware of some of the difficulties some of our students were going to encounter in the workplace when they went looking for work, because some of the behaviour they were displaying online would make it really difficult for them to gain insurance as an employee, to gain a footing in the workplace, and to be taken seriously by their patients, but also to be good representatives of their profession. So for that reason, I've been lobbying to try to be allowed to teach on this subject at King's. And then actually last year I was presenting in Italy. I was going to present at a dental conference in Italy, and I'd put some slides together on this subject, and I was worried that they were really flat and boring, because I was on first in the afternoon in a room with no air conditioning straight after a meal, and I knew people were going to have wine with their lunch and it was going to be quite hot. And I was terrified that people would just doze off during my presentation, which I thought was terrific and I wanted everybody to pay lots of attention to. And I explained this to my husband and my son, who was at the time, my son was 10, and I showed them this video I'd found online by this amazing guy called Eric Qualman from the USA. And I said to my husband, I wish I had the money to build something like Eric Qualman. And Simon said, well, you don't, there you go. So off I went to collect my daughter from violin. And when I came back, my son, who's 10, had merged my slides with Eric Qualman's slides with the same music, which is popular music by this guy called Fatboy Slim, and it was all paced perfectly in time. And my son said, look, Mum, I've made this for you. And I was so proud of him and so pleased, but just quite alarmed that he'd no idea about copyright violations. So the other thing that subsequently happened was I went to a conference in August, and one of the keynote speakers at AMI, which is the it's a large medical education conference, the keynote speaker on his first speech thanked Google Images for the 25 images he'd lifted off Google and put into his slides. So he'd complete lack of awareness. You can be fined about $2,000 per image that you lift off Google. So all of these issues around digital literacy, a lot of our students are incredibly literate, but they don't realise when they're breaking the law, and they don't realise how what they're doing online can impact negatively on them when they go to look for work. So where's my special stick? I'm just going to show you my son's super film, because I'm a boastful parent, but also because I want you to see about the power of social media. And I have asked Eric Qualman, who designed this video, what he thought of it, and he said I was to feel free to use it because he thinks my son is cool as well. So I'm just going to show you this. One of those is a dog and the rest are cats. And it says there's a spy amongst us. That's my 10-year-old. I'm just going to stop that there. What we're talking about here is we've built an internal social network just for our students. It's called Kinship. And I'll explain to you about why we think that's really important in a moment. But I don't think a lot of our students have processed the fact that we can, and it is obviously very easy now to follow people and to realise what they're, to work out what they're doing online. So for example, there is now a generator that you can access online that will tell you what the most commonly downloaded, illegal downloaded game or song or film is anywhere. And that's all across Europe. So for example, I know the most prolifically downloaded, illegally downloaded on this campus today is Ed Sheeran, Lego House. Which my son was horrified by because he thinks it's a really dreadful song. But this is the thing. I don't think students realise when they're logged onto our computers, if one of the music companies comes to us and wants to know why, who's downloading this, actually we know who's logged in on that IP address. And ultimately they can be sued for up to $2,000 per song. And I don't think the university is going to be prepared to pay for that moving forward. But what we need to do is be alerting the students to the fact that they could get a criminal record because of their online activities, which they consider to be okay because it's endemic. Does that make sense? It isn't okay. It's like last year we had rioting in London, lots of people joined in. None of them realised that they would all subsequently be arrested because everything, that we live in a surveillance society, everything is seen that you do. What I try to teach our students and the training that we're rolling out across the whole university through the use of Kinship is, we're trying to teach students about the impact of their digital life on their employability. So, for example, what students don't realise is social networks, commercial social networks like Facebook, LinkedIn and Twitter, the student is not the customer. None of us here are the customers of Facebook. The advertisers are the customers. We are the commodity, and the commercial platforms are selling access to our data in order to make money. So any of you who use social media, be under no illusion, there is no privacy in there. Anything can turn up. And what I'm showing the students is how that can impact on their employability. Now, this is a cartoon, and it's very American-centric, so you may not get it. But Craigslist in the USA is an online place where people sell things like cars and rent rooms, that kind of thing. And this basically is a guy standing behind the guy on the desk, and he says he's putting all his stuff to store in Chad's garage. It's really cool. And then he gets a note off Chad, and Chad is going to sell it all on Craigslist. And the guy who's standing up says, this is disgraceful. How can you run a storage business like this? Chad's not running a storage business, okay? And I think the students don't realize that Facebook is not just a pretty place for you to display all of your pictures. It's somewhere that's going to be mined by people who want to use it for advertising. And if you're very clear about that, then what you realize is, despite locking down your privacy settings, advertisers have access to every piece of content that you put online. And I think the students are often quite shocked because that has actual implications for civil liberties. And I think we all need to be thinking about these things. We've built an internal social network because we want the students, when they collaborate for the purposes of research or when they communicate on documents, when they work together for assignments, that what they do in school stays in school. It's not being mined by anybody. We're not looking at where it was done. We're not putting geotags in there that will work out where their locations were. And that's really creepy. I'll show you a bit about that in a moment. But if we just move on, what digital professionalism is the skill or competence expected of a professional when engaged in digital communications. That's just amended from a dictionary definition of professionalism, but that's actually what works in this space. And Julian Schreeder from the British Medical Association pointed out the key problems with social last November. He said there's confusion about the extent to which information is private. And that is true. At the moment, we're having students with issues around a new app called Snapchat. Snapchat has become prolifically popular in the USA, and what it does is people are sending each other intimate messages and photographs, just use your imagination, and they expire after a few seconds, and you can choose how many seconds that will be. So people are sending each other really risque pictures, and when I showed that to my 10-year-old, because I was playing with it, because I like to know how to use all of these things, he immediately picked up an iPad and took a photograph of the picture that I was going to put on Snapchat. So nothing disappears after 10 seconds. You can screenshot anything, keep anything, reproduce it, send it anywhere. So if you consider that in the context of what our students could be sending each other and how that could impact negatively on them, it's incredible naivety to believe that your students are not doing this right now, because I promise you they are. The next thing is the ease with which information can be broadcast. I know this really well. I had a blog. I started a blog 6 years ago, writing as an alter ego. I pretended I had a really affluent lifestyle, and I got offered a column in the Telegraph newspaper and a sitcom and a book out of it because people believed what I wrote. And it was just pure escapism for me. But you're infinitely quotable, and people believe what they read online. So if you write outrageous things, I don't know, if you're a young arts student in Scotland, you don't know that you're actually going to marry a prince and become a princess in the longer term, but what you've said on Snapchat could make nice fodder for a tabloid newspaper. So we all have to think about how what we're saying can be taken out of context and what the ramifications of that can be. The informality of social working can make it really easy to fall foul of defamation laws, and I'll give you an example of that in a moment. But personal and professional boundaries can be rendered porous. And for that reason, a lot of the medical unions and nursing unions, the clinical unions, are saying now that students should not friend patients, that clinicians should not friend clients. And actually, that is something that we at King's think is fair for tutors and members of staff should not be expected to have to friend students in order to network with them for the purpose of academic work. And there are a lot of documents that are being published, a lot of journal articles at the moment that are suggesting it's a great idea. If you look to the USA, it's a really poor idea because lots of academic staff have come unstuck and ended up with criminal records over what they've been communicating with students about. So you need to think very carefully about the kinds of platforms and media and functionality that your staff are communicating with students on right now, okay? So your digital footprint is anything that's left online. It affects you personally, it can affect you professionally, it can affect your employer, and it can affect your clients and patients. And when I talk about your digital footprint, I'm talking even if you don't have Facebook or Twitter, don't think it doesn't apply to you. It can apply to those slides that you put on SlideShare. It can be the history of what you've searched online. It can be the shops that you've visited online. If you've gone online at all, you have a digital footprint. And if I call on examples that I've come across in the past, I've had clinical people who've contacted me who are very alarmed about some of the issues that have come up for them in their clinical practice. So for example, I had a clinician who had a patient who came to him who had an oral ulcer, who thought that he had cancer because he'd Googled this oral ulcer and wanted to discuss it with the clinician. The clinician Googled oral ulcer on his laptop with the patient to see if he could find the same search that the patient had found, and he found gay porn. And this clinician was saying to me, how come my search looked like that? Because that didn't happen for the patient. And actually what was happening for that clinician was that was normally what he looked at lunchtime, and Google with cookies was starting to tailor his searches according to what he normally looked up. Does that make sense? So we're talking to students now about clearing their cookies. We're talking to all of our tutors about clearing their cookies, because if you're somebody who pitches up to do a training and you use your own laptop, which I often do, sometimes you can end up logging into sites to show students things on a rostrum, and they can actually end up seeing the history of your searches. And I have had examples of that happen to me too, where my recent shopping has come up down the side and I'm mortified because somebody who's with me can see all the underwear I've just recently bought. And you know, everybody deserves their privacy. I can give you so many examples of this. It's seriously, seriously quite embarrassing. This is a story that came up just before Christmas. One of our politicians' wives is very free with what she says on Twitter. And it's gotten her into trouble. She's actually going to be prosecuted. But what's actually happened was there was a politician was accused of being a paedophile, and he actually was not he was not guilty of what they said. It was a mix-up over a name. And this politician's wife, Sally Burko, tweeted, "Why is Lord McAlpine trending innocent face?" She never said that he was a paedophile. She asked why he was trending. And Lord McAlpine is suing her now for defamation, and I believe he will be successful. But what's most so important to me about this tweet is it's copyright of Twitter. And what our students and staff, what people don't seem to realise is everything you say on these social platforms is permanent. So even if you go back and delete, if Sally Bercow immediately deleted that tweet, if somebody else has already retweeted it, it's out there. But even so, if Lord McAlpine or anybody else has seen it, they can ask Twitter to hand over the sum of what she's said. There's an organisation in the UK called the IT Legal Community, and they send out monthly updates to everybody who's involved in law in the UK. And in January last year, they sent out a briefing that highlighted if you're having to prosecute or scrutinise somebody, say even for the purpose of their insurance, if they make an insurance claim and claim, and this has already happened in the USA, say they had an insurance policy that said that they don't normally take part in dangerous sports. If they subsequently make a claim for a back injury, and you can show from what they've done on Facebook that they've been bungee jumping, it makes their it makes their insurance invalid. Does that make sense?
Does everybody know what bungee jumping is?
It's using a huge elastic band and jumping off a bridge, but it wouldn't be a particularly safe sport, put it that way. So what happened from last January was, there have been cases have come up subsequently, like for example, a law student in Newcastle in the UK was accused of racially abusing one of our football players. And in September, he got something like 68 hours of community service and a relatively small fine of less than £1,000 for racially abusing Stan Collymore. But what was really interesting in that case was his prosecutor was able to get the sum of his social media, which included every message he'd sent on BlackBerry Messenger, every private message he'd ever sent on Facebook. And she was able to demonstrate that he'd boasted about his new hobby. He had claimed in his defense that this was a random aberration. This was a one-off that he'd racially abused Stan Collymore. He actually tried to claim that a friend, had logged in onto his Facebook and done it on him. But she was able to illustrate a pattern of behavior that showed that he was racist. Does that make sense? Because if anybody ever accuses him of racism in the future, it's already been proved that he was. Does that make sense? Our students are too free, our staff are too free with what they're saying on social, and they don't consider it permanent. So we're giving them a safer place to model their digital voice. If you look at this image here, this is a case from last September, Queen's University in Belfast. Their students were involved. It started with a boy on Facebook started a group where he was showing photographs of girls coming home from a wild night out the next day in the same clothes. In this country, the students call it the walk of shame. I don't know what you call it abroad. But he started this group, and Queen's University felt that he was bringing shame on the university, embarrassment on other students in his group, and that he was misogynistic. And he's gotten into trouble over this, but it would take only three clicks of a mouse and I will find out who that boy is. It's very easy to search these things online. And that could affect his career for the whole of his life. He can get an amazing medical degree. He can qualify as a lawyer. Will he practice as a lawyer? Will he get an interview? It's very interesting because these things are all coming back to roost. This is from January the 4th. This is Swansea University. In Wales, a group of students started, there was an anonymised group on Facebook that was started, where students were asked to come onto that group and to volunteer embarrassing stories about that university. And some of the students actually went on and said about how they'd been having trysts with tutors in order to make their grades better. Does that make sense? It turned up on the BBC, it got national press coverage, and we were horrified. But actually, we found a group like this last week from King's, and immediately, because we were watching the internet, we were able to get that group taken down. And our rationale for getting that group taken down is that will impact on other students within the year group, it will impact on our university, and it will impact on employability of the students here. But actually, if we just look at the content of this group, although what students were saying, what they were confessing to is anonymous, the comments within these groups are not anonymous. So if I comment on there as a student with a normal account, my comment comes up with my name on it. Now, this is just people being unkind about somebody who had a bad footwear choice that day. It doesn't seem too harsh. This chap used very bad language. He had no security settings on his Facebook profile. I clicked into his Facebook profile and he was a member of a group that were making confessions about embarrassing sexual situations they'd been in. He was also in a group that was making fun of Christians. And to be completely honest with you, if he comes to me for a job, I don't care about his qualifications. I am a Christian and I would be mortified, and I would consider him to be a loose cannon in my dental practice if he came to work with me, because I would think he would impact negatively on my orthodontic practice and I would not want him in my team. But actually, he's not alone. This is how students commonly behave. They now commonly have a 7-year career of using social media before they get to your campus. They will impact negatively on their own careers. They will impact negatively on your brand if you're not watching this and giving them a safer place to step back. Okay? Now, this is another picture of one of our students. This is typical of the kind of image that I pick up regularly. They don't realize when they mention where they are. This says the Greenwood Lecture Theatre, that I have searches on these words and I'll instantly pick them up and I'll wave to them on Twitter. I'll send them a little asterisk waves too, and I'll say, please take that down. Because if this is a clinical student, for example, and they're regularly posting images of how they sleep through renal lectures, for example, when they qualify and they have a poor outcome of the renal system, a litigating barrister will get his clerk, who's much cheaper than the barrister's time, to scroll down through his timeline and find images that illustrate the fact that the student was studying enough to pass the exam, not enough to be a diligent clinician. Does that make sense? The same goes for when they come out of an exam and they say on Twitter and Facebook and everything else how delighted they are that the neurological system didn't come up because they knew nothing about it. That's a really bad idea. So we're talking to students right now about the implications of their digital lives. Now, this is a piece of an infographic by a company called Repler. They published this last January. They did a study in New York of 3,000 employers and they asked them if they're using Facebook to shortlist. And what I found shocking about this is 76% of employers at that point were using Facebook, not LinkedIn, Facebook. It doesn't shock me now, because I know, because of the work that I do, I get contacted all the time by employers. And they tell me they use Facebook to shortlist. But what's interesting about this little diagram across the bottom is 47 look after receiving the initial application. So a student has sat down for 2 or 3 hours and gone through that application form and thought about their supporting statement, submitted the application form, and then they fell down because they were looked up online. If you look, it's only 4% that haven't looked right up until they make the offer. They haven't looked at somebody on Facebook. And that's not shocking to me now, because as recently as this week, I've heard of two employers in the UK who have asked students to log into Facebook at interview. And how they defend that is they say the students have given consent at interview. And this is a very crowded workplace where our students are competing just to get an interview. You don't want to go to an interview, be asked to log into your Facebook, and then be seen to say that you're really not looking forward to your interview. And as I've heard recently, somebody saying, I never wanted to do psychology anyway, I just wanted to be a medic. You know, if you're looking for work, you're not that free with what you say. We don't have Tourette's. We think things, we don't necessarily articulate them. It will impact negatively on your brand. So what we're teaching at King's is, we're teaching students to take a step back to measure what they say in any social environment, because it will impact on their brand. And this is a screenshot of the front page of Kinship. And I have lots of students who say to me, why should we use the internal social network? We're already on a number of social networks. But we want them to have a safer place to model their digital brand. And they're saying to me, why would I say something on the university's social network? Because the tutors will see me and then I will get into trouble. But they should always consider that what they say could cause them to be under scrutiny. Does that make sense? I hope they feel very intimidated on here, because I want them to always feel intimidated using social, because it will impact and is impacting on their employability right now. So why do we need an internal social network at university when we have all of these? Well, actually, in September in America, Twitter was asked to hand over the sum of all of the data that Twitter had on anybody who was arrested in the Occupy Wall Street demonstrations. And that was really interesting, because Twitter then handed over in September the geotagged location updates of everybody who was using Twitter who was arrested. BlackBerry Messenger handed over all of the messages also. So the district attorney in New York can build up a comprehensive picture of every single person who took part in those demonstrations. And I think that's a threat to civil liberties. I have to say, when I realised and heard that people who are paedophiles were using Twitter to exchange images, I was horrified, and I thought that it would be great that Twitter could expose these people and we could find out who they are and track them down. But actually, if everything everybody says is ultimately up there for grabs and up there to be taken by a government who may not like your opinion, and actually bear in mind as well, all of those icons that I showed you for social networks, they're all USA hosted. So think about that. We have Kinship is UK hosted and it's UK law applies for us. Okay, so that was in September in the USA. And you think, will that happen here? Well, actually, this is a case last Friday in France. The French government have asked Twitter to hand over all of the data that they have on people who've made anti-Semitic tweets. In the past couple of months. And you could argue, yes, that's a worthy thing to do, but actually, where will this stop? And I think actually we need to be talking, having a dialogue with our students about the threat to civil liberties that this is, because it is a threat to civil liberties. We also need to talk to them about how they moderate what they share online. And I think this is something we're rolling out across all of the schools here. Every medical student in King's has to do an online course on this every year. They also have to attend a lecture. It's compulsory. It's just being made compulsory for all dental students to do this every year. It's being rolled out to nursing as well. They're all having to do the lecture. Maths students. I'm being approached by big banks in the city who are asking me to shortlist their graduates. So bear that in mind. This is affecting employability right now. This is a quote from Voltaire. I celebrate my right to free speech, but I think we need to measure carefully what we share. And then I just want to draw your attention to something that we have at King's, World Questions, King's Answers. The students are very excited about the prospect of debating this issue, of being involved in the dialogue around free speech and what these new precedents in law may have. What the effects may be on their civil liberties in the longer term. And I would love our students to be involved with the fine minds in here. This building is actually the law school. We've got some amazing people who are doing some work on cyber terrorism also. So we've got some really informed people who can be involved in that dialogue and debate with our students. But then I just want to show you just one short film at the end now. Thank you very much. Thank you. Sorry.
Tegen alles is goed. Ja. Insecten.
Dat lief?
Ik voel twee insecten op je rug. Kan dat?
Ja. Vlinders.
Slovenië.
Slovenië.
Eén motto. Oranje.
Pas erop.
Zenit.
Oui, oui, bien.
Je hebt een vriendin. Julie.
Ja.
Doe je in het liefdesleven?
Vierde, daar zwijg ik meestal over, dus dat weten niet veel mensen.
Is het een plus voor? Maison rouge, balcon, blanc. Ja. Ik zie geld, ik zie transacties, maar ik ken je rekeningnummer van buiten. Ik denk dat ik het wel weet. Die staat wel negatief op je bankrekening.
Ja?
9-7, last month. Spent 200 euro's aan alcohol. Vorige maand 300 euro aan kleding gespendeerd. 8,
yes.
5 voor een huis dat van eigenaar gaat veranderen. Zo'n 30.000 euro.
Uiteindelijk.
41.